Today, we are going to talk about the Kayin conflict, which is the longest civil war ever happened in any country in the history of mankind. So, the place of origin is the country of Myanmar, formerly known as Burma, which was a former British territory, sharing its borders with Bangladesh, India, China, Laos, Thailand, and Malaysia. So, here, as you can see in the upcoming picture, the Kayin National Liberation Army marching.
National flag of Myanmar, and this is the flag of Kayin. The Kayin conflict is an armed conflict in Kayin State of Myanmar, formerly known as Kayin State, Burma. The conflict has been described as one of the world's longest running civil wars. Kayin nationalists have been fighting for an independent state known as Kawthoolei since 1949. In a world where conflict arises from ethnic and religious differences, Myanmar is not often a name that is brought up, but perhaps represents one of the most complicated and longest cases of ongoing ethnic conflict in a country. Today, due to the internal ethnic conflict, it is estimated that almost 1.5 million people are internally displaced. The government, which has been controlled by the military since 1962, has attempted peace talks with belligerent groups. But ceasefire deals have broken down time after time. To understand why this civil war has been raging for so long, the country's complexities and the reasoning behind this conflict must be understood. Myanmar, a former British colony that is also referred to as Burma because of the Burman ethnic majority, consists of 135 ethnic groups. The Burman people make up 66% of the population, while 8 other minority groups account for 30.5% of the population, and the remaining groups represent the last 4.5%. While 89% of the population is Buddhists, Muslims, and Christians make up 4% of the population. Thus, Kayin people make up Myanmar's Christian population, and it is thus Kayin that began and still continues to drive the Kayin nationalist movement. Thus, Kayin were converted to Christianity by Protestant American missionaries in the 19th century. They were taught English, became more literate in their own language, which had been modernized by the missionaries and were taught by the Americans, about their own history and traditions. This caused the Kayin people to become increasingly nationalistic, and because of their English literacy and Protestant Christianity, they allied themselves to be colonial British, aiding them in putting down the Burman rebellions in the Three Anglo-Burmese War, in the Siasan Rebellion in the early 1930s. As you can see here, the surrendering ceremony marched past the Second World War. The Kayin fought alongside the British against the invading Japan. During the Second World War, the Kayin fought alongside the British against the invading Japanese, who were aided by the Burman. When Japan captured Rangoon, the capital city, the British forces retreated to India, leaving the Kayin at the mercy of the Burman and Japanese, who began systematically killing the Kayin. The Japanese occupation ended in 1945 when the Allied forces recaptured Myanmar. The Kayin leadership believed that their aiding of the British had earned them the right to have an independent state, but this hope was denied by the newly formed, primarily Burman government. The newly formed government established parliamentary rule, but leftist groups such as the Communist Party of Burma and the Kayin National Union, which represented the Kayin minority in Myanmar, believed that they and the other ethnic groups were being excluded from government involvement. The Kayin National Union called for an independent Kayin state and the organization's military wing. The Kayin National Liberation Army began a campaign that conquered most of the countryside. Thanks to the recent Japanese occupation of Myanmar, there are plenty of leftover weapons for the anti-government groups to utilize. Along with the Kayin people, many other ethnic groups such as San, Arkanese, Chin, and Kachin also call for independent states. The Kachin people form an alliance with the Kayin, But a lack of trust, along with interest disagreement, allowed the Burma army to take back much of the land it had lost. However, to the north, Mao Zedong's People's Republic of China was threatening to invade Myanmar. Myanmar was seen as ethnically divided, and the government in the 1960 election was strongly considering a constitutional amendment that would turn the country into a federal system. Combined with economic woes and the decline of Myanmar's nationalism, the country was ripe for regain change, which came in the form of bloodless military coup led in 1962. The new military government turned Myanmar into a one-party socialist military dictatorship. In an effort to prevent Thai and Burmese communist forces from unifying, both the United States and Thai government provided both the Karen National Union and the Myanmar government with weapons, which the two groups in turn used against each other. The Karen movement gradually declined after losing support from Thailand in the late 1960s, but never actually died because of the Karen state's proximity in the northern Myanmar to Thailand, which promoted cross-border trade. Violent conflict continued in the Karen state, and the Karen National Union rebuilt efforts to rebuild a relationship with the Thai government in 1976. The Thai government ultimately stopped all support of the Karen movement in 1997 when Myanmar joined Association of Southeast Asian Nations, that is ASEAN. Since then, the Karen movement has split into seven different factions, all fighting the military government in the Karen state until 2011, when total military rule officially ended. As of now, the Karen National Union barely holds any territory within Myanmar, but to stay afloat, it, along with other insurgency groups, have become heavily involved in the cross-border opium trade with Thailand. Myanmar is the second largest producer of opium in the world, and is the largest provider of methamphetamine products in Southeast Asia. The opium trafficking industry brings in an estimated $2 billion annual revenue for Myanmar's drug lords. And while this has aided Myanmar's economy, it also perpetuates internal ethnic conflicts. The military government's hands have not been clean of human rights abuses in this conflict. In 2005, a Harvard study found that during a military campaign known as the Offensive, Myanmar's army had been attacking the civilian areas, destroying the food stores, and like violating of international law, and have resulted in the displacement of tens of thousands of individuals and the deaths of many. In the overall span of the Karen conflict, millions have fled the Karen state and Myanmar together. The Myanmar army has also been accused of violence, forced labor, and the use of child soldiers in their campaign. The Rohingya Muslims, another minority group, have been suffering what has been called an ethnic cleansing at the hands of Buddhist monks. Their leader, U Win Thao, calls for boycotting a Muslim business and for violent attack against Rohingya. In one instance, Buddhist monks burned 70 homes in Wakhan, a town north of Rangoon, killing one person and injuring nine, all because a Muslim girl on a bike collided with a Buddhist monk. There is also legal discrimination against both Muslims and Christians in Myanmar. On July 7, 2015, the parliament voted into law a bill that prohibits interfaith marriage. Though democracy again is on the rise in Myanmar, the country has yet to achieve peace since its conception in 1948. Though the situation in Myanmar has long been nearly hopeless, there is a chance that the government could bring about peace in the very near future. In March 2015, 16 rebel groups signed a ceasefire agreement with the government, and in November of the same year, the opposition National League for Democracy won the majority of the seats in the parliament election, allowing them to form a new government. The leader of the party, Aung San Suu Kyi, is perhaps Myanmar's most famous pro-democratic activist. The daughter of Aung San, who led Myanmar's liberation movement, she was under house arrest in Myanmar for 15 years because of her political activism, and quickly became one of the most prominent political prisoners in the world, being awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1991 for her leading of non-violent protest and call for ethnic peace. Although she cannot be the president of Myanmar due to her marriage to a non-Burman, her role as party president will be integral. Aung San Suu Kyi has called for her people to recognize the desired autonomy of the country's ethnic group and has pushed for real democracy in the government, but she will need the backing of the Myanmar military in order to make his dream a reality. The military is still the most powerful player in the government, and if any constitutional amendment are to be made in future, it requires at least one military legislature. The former Lieutenant General of the Tatmadaw, Myanmar's army, has vowed that the military will help any government succeed in this peace process. The government will change soon, but the peace process will not change. Whether the military's idea of peace is an alignment with Aung San Suu Kyi is still to be seen, but this does bode well for the future. If the military is on Aung San Suu Kyi's side, then she can push for constitutional amendment allowing interfaith marriage in Myanmar, thus allowing her to take role of president. This would help stop discrimination against the Christian and Muslim ethnic groups, strengthening the trust between the Karen and Rohingya people and the new government. A peaceful Myanmar can help the country focus on infrastructure development, which will better equip it against the national disasters and have frequently plagued the country and have resulted in displacing of millions, as well as better the country's economic situation and move it away from its dominant opium trade. Aung San Suu Kyi and the new National League for Democracy in Myanmar's new government have massive challenges facing them, but if they can succeed, Myanmar's future will be bright.